અમદાવાદ ગીતા મંદિર.
Okay, let us start our third session, which is the most important session, which is about the sizing procedure to be followed for indoor remotely controlled airships. Kindly confirm to me that you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
So this particular session will be conducted for the next 15 minutes. And then again after lunch. Okay, so and here we have to go very slowly because here we have to clarify all your doubts. So this is not for information, this is for learning. So therefore, kindly do not hesitate and ask me your doubts as we go. Make it interactive. So what was the motivation to make this particular procedure? The motivation is that many places where I go and give a talk about LTS systems, students get motivated to make LTS systems. And they say that we would like to make aerostats or airships. Today, we'll talk only about airships. Unfortunately, as I mentioned, the recommended activity to take up if you want to work on airships is an indoor remotely controlled airship. Why am I saying indoor? Can someone try to elaborate? Why am I insisting on indoor?
Sir, because it is easy to work on and cost effective as we are students.
That is one thing. Any other application? Any other reason?
Sir, we don't have to consider the changes of airspeed or environmental changes.
There will be some environmental effect, but it will be controllable. It will be within your limits. Any other reason?
Sir, ease of design?
Design-wise, there is not much difference actually. I mean, design-wise, you can design anything. Fabrication will be easier because it is going to be smaller. Generally, it is going to be smaller. But more important is that in an LTS system, if for some reason you lose control, what happens?
Sir, it is still recoverable.
In LTS system, how do you recover it if you lose control?
Sir, if it's heavier than air, like it's designed heavier than air, it will settle down. Or else if it is not heavier than air, it will just go up and explode when the ambient density of the atmosphere is very less.
Not necessary. It may not explode. See, it will explode only if the buoyancy is so much extra that it climbs to a high altitude where the pressure breaks the envelope. What will happen is that it will go out of control. See, when you make a UAV, when you make a drone, when you make a quadcopter, suppose you lose control, the quadcopter will fall on the ground because of gravity. But in an airship, you are overcoming gravity by the buoyancy. So you have to tie it down always. You have to always hold it. And if you lose control, then it will fly away from you without you having any control on it. because there is no gravity to bring it down. So that is why before you make an airship, you have to now make a payload recovery device or some kind of a safety device. Secondly, an outdoor airship is too much affected by winds. So it will be very difficult for you to start handling it when you are new. And there is a very good chance that you will tear the envelope. And it has happened to many people that they have started, they have not taken my advice and they have started working. And they have not been able to handle it properly and it tore. So that is why my recommendation is, I don't want you to lose your motivation. I don't want you to lose your excitement and passion. You make something and then suddenly you lose it. It brings a very bad name. Most probably you will be using hydrogen because of the cost and the availability considerations. Now a hydrogen filled balloon of a large size, if it is flying away without your control, it can go and damage somebody and there it may catch fire. Then you will have a very bad name. So that's why my recommendation is start the activities with an indoor remotely controlled airship. Second thing is, when you make an airship, it should look like an actual airship. Okay, it is very easy to make a spherical airship or oblate spheroid or lenticular or a fancy shape. But that is not our purpose. We are not here for entertaining people. We are here for educating people. We are here for showing people what airships can do and what airships cannot do. So therefore, the requirement is that it should look like an actual or a proper airship. It should not be a fancy shape just for ease in manufacture. Okay. What is meant by a lenticular shape? Can you explain to me what is meant by a lenticular shape?
Sir, a little bit similar to UFO shape.
Correct. Somewhat similar to UFOs. Flat shapes which are circular in the top view, ellipsoid in the side view, okay, and which are like, the correct definition is like a dal. Also, an airship is meaningless if it cannot lift anything, because then what is the purpose you show? So many students are tempted to make an airship which is zero payload capacity, because when you will soon realize that the moment you start adding payload, the size becomes larger. When size becomes larger, it becomes difficult to make, difficult to handle. But it is very important that whether it is 50 grams or 100 grams or 500 grams, there should be some reserve payload capacity in the airship. Also, when you make the airship for the first time, you are going to make a lot of mistakes in the assumptions. You're going to make a lot of errors in the calculations. And with these errors in the calculation, you are going to have a error in the payload capacity. So therefore, it is very important that there should be some spare payload capacity so that there is a margin for you to make small errors. Thirdly, an airship that you make should have a three-axis control. Why is it required to have three-axis control? What is the reason to have three-axis control?
Sir, to maneuver and doing pitch for landing purpose.
For landing purposes, you may not need three-axis control, but you definitely need three-axis control if you want to showcase the working of the airship. And if you want to showcase how it works, okay. So yes, definitely, it is a good idea. It is a good idea to have some payload capacity at least. Okay. Correct. 1 minute, please. Right. So now let us first define the problem. The problem is that there is no systematic design approach available in open literature for you to start and say, okay, if I follow this procedure 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I can make a small airship. So if you try and search for textbooks or any guides, you will not find any systematic approach available. So that is why we made this methodology for you. Second thing, the need for this thing is, to make a design fabrication methodology for non-rigid indoor airship. Now, I have already explained to you what is meant by a non-rigid airship. Can somebody explain to me back what it is?
Sir, like there will be no internal structure and all the payload will be attached to the fabric envelope.
So why should we make a non-rigid airship? What is the advantage or disadvantage of non-rigid airship?
Sir, one of the advantage will be it will be a lightweight as no structure is there, and disadvantage may be it will be not much, it will not have much strength. Structural strength.
So do you want to have a structure with poor strength?
No, sir.
So what is the advantage of a non-rigid airship? One thing is very clear. Okay, so I'll tell you, non-rigid airships are simpler to make. They are also very easy to transport, because if you have a rigid airship, you cannot fold it. If you have a semi-rigid airship, you cannot fold it. Suppose you make an airship of 5 meter length, then to carry it, you have to continuously have a 5 meter free space. If you have to come to Mumbai to show it to me, then how do you bring it? It will be very difficult to bring it unless you make it some foldable type, which is very difficult. So that's why if you want to make an airship which can be easily packed and transported, the easiest is to make a non-rigid airship. Secondly, payload capacity up to 2250 grams. While doing a survey, we found that most of the cameras along with their battery and other features like lenses, they can fit within a weight of around 250 grams. So you will get a decent payload capacity. Making an airship bigger than this capacity will lead to make it larger in size, higher in volume. Okay. So therefore, in this methodology, we are saying that let us limit ourselves to 250. Although the methodology does not have any limit, you can size it also for a 500 gram airship. But I am suggesting that the first airship that you make, let it have a payload capacity of around 250 grams, which is quite decent. Then the next thing is electrically powered. Why do you think it should be electrically powered? What is the other option you have for powering an airship? What kind of power system? What kind of power
system? It may be manual, the other option.
Manual means what?
Sir, means you have to handle it with, with those strings and all.
No, then you are not flying.
Okay.
You need an engine. Definitely you need an engine. You cannot say, I will run with the airship and that is my airship.
So maybe fuel powered?
Using IC engines.
Yes, sir.
So what is the problem in using an IC engine for a small airship like this?
So it will become quite heavier.
Correct. That is one thing. Actually, if you look at IC engines, they actually have a good power to weight ratio for low sizes. Most of the remotely controlled aircraft that you see, they normally have these small IC engines. Okay. But I will not recommend using an IC engine for an airship. What is the reason?
It's a cost.
No, they are cheaper. Or maybe same price. Cost is not the main reason.
Sir, maybe the emission and the heat it requires.
Emission? Are you really worried about emission for a small indoor remotely controlled airship? Tell me. When you make a small RC,
sir, it may be equivalent to heavier than air.
No, why will it be heavier than air? I mean, it's an engine. It gives you thrust.
Sir, maybe vibrations.
Vibrations is one reason. Agreed. Vibration could be one reason. How many of you have had the experience of making a small aircraft with IC engine? Is there anybody in the audience who has made remotely controlled aircraft with IC engines? That is why you don't know. It is not very easy to start a small IC engine which is meant for aero modeling. You have to learn the trick. You have to put a glow plug and then you have to move the propeller by hand, you have to flick it by hand, or you have to use a starter. It requires some skill and some experience. Number two, Number two, the problem is that in an electrical powered airship, it is very much possible for you to stop and start. Okay. Stop and start. Because you can reverse the direction of the motor very easily. You can also stop and start the motor. But an IC engine is very difficult to stop. It will go into idling, but it will not go into zero. Correct? So that is the reason why I recommend electrically powered motors to be used for airships. The next constraint I want to suggest is keep the length below 4 meters. The reason is that you can make larger airships, but then if you are an indoor airship, anything more than 4 meters, there are very limited areas where you can fly it. Okay, so these constraints have actually come from experience and these are suggestions. You don't want to agree to these, it is up to you. But these are my recommendations. And that is why I think we should know about our constraints before we start. The testing arena for the airship will be either an indoor hall or a classroom. Okay. So in your college, which is the largest sized indoor hall that is available? How many seats are there in that hall? And where is it located?
Sir, we have quite a huge hall in the thermal lab and the workshop area.
Yeah, but it must be having some equipment on the bottom.
Yes, sir.
So you have to always fly above the equipment, and suppose your airship goes and, I mean, it's possible to manage in that hall, okay? Any other place where we don't have equipment on the ground, on the floor?
So we have basement.
You have a basement. So what is the height of the basement?
Yes.
What is the basement height from the floor?
Sir, nearly 15 feet.
15 feet. And average. are there any pillars in between?
No, sir.
So if there are no pillars and you have a 15 feet height, then that could be a good place for you to play. So anyway, you have to decide where to do it. It is up to you. Okay. Now, looking at our experience with airships, because we have made many, many small remotely controlled indoor airships. So we came up with these requirements, and I want to just explain to you one by one why the requirements are important. First of all, we want it to be portable, and the dimensions are 68 centimeter by 49 centimeter by 28 centimeter. Any idea how these numbers have come?
Sir, it might be the dimension of box.
Yeah, but why am I giving such a dimension? Why not 70 by 50 by 20 by 30? So these are dimensions of a large size suitcase, which is easily available. And we wanted to fit everything inside that particular suitcase. Now you might say that an airship is a non-rigid airship. It's only an envelope. So why do we require so much space? Because there are going to be other components which have to be carried along with the airship when you transport it. I will show it to you later. Second thing is, ready to fly in less than 1 hour. This is to ensure that you don't get frustrated and bored that if I want to fly the airship for a demo, I require 5 hours or 3 hours to assemble. It should be designed in such a way that you can quickly assemble it. It should be maneuverable. It should be able to do a spot turn. That means it should be able to turn where it is. This is not possible in the case of a fixed wing aircraft. They need some minimum radius of turn. But I want it to have a zero radius of turn. And I want the airship to be able to move in all 6 directions. So please tell me, what will be the constraint imposed because of this requirement? First of all, why do I want to do a spot turn?
Sir, because the rolling movement is hard in airships due to the inertia at the bottom.
So because of that?
The spot turn is preferable.
No. Spot turn is not preferable. As I mentioned to you, you can turn the airship comfortably with rudders. So spot turn is not essential. An airship can be turned using rudders also. Of course, it will require some radius.
So why if it wants to, sir, if it wants to hover and hover above a certain location and get a view of 360 degree maybe.
Okay, that is possible. If you want to hover the airship and if you want to move it around 360 degrees, then you need to do a spot turn. Very right. Anything else? Remember, you are going to work in a small enclosed space. You are not working in open air with open ground where there is enough volume available. You are working in a limited area. So if you don't have spot turn availability, then you will not be able to fly properly inside a small enclosed area. With a spot turn ability, you can actually fly in a small enclosed area. Okay. Volume, I am saying, managed with 1/4 cylinder of LDA gas. Typically, hydrogen and helium are available in 7 m³ cylinders. But all the gas doesn't come out because of the loss of pressure as you start deflating. Generally, we found that we can get maximum of 6 to 6.5 m³ from the cylinder. Remaining gas remains in the cylinder and comes out very slowly. So I want you to manage with 1/4 cylinder so that with one cylinder you can do at least 4 trials. Otherwise, every time you do a trial, you will require to buy a cylinder. And that is not very easy. It is expensive, plus it is logistically a problem. So our experience is that if you make a small airship, don't make it so large that every time you fly, you require a lot of gas to be filled in. It's also costly. Endurance, 15 minutes. Why this number has come? This should be minimum 15 minutes. Because that is a time that is required to really showcase something and to impress people. If you make an airship which can fly only for 3 minutes, it is too small a time before you have to go and change the battery or before you have to go and do something. So it should be able to fly nonstop for about 15 minutes. Only then you are able to excite and impress the audience. Okay. The other two things you already know, I have already talked about that in the previous one. At any point of time, friends, if you have a doubt, you are welcome to ask. Because don't take anything I'm telling you on face value. You should agree to it and you should be able to understand the reason. Okay. Shall I go ahead?
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, is this endurance time... we can increase the endurance time.
I'm saying minimum 15 minutes. I am saying minimum 15 minutes. But if you make it 30 minutes, nobody is going to say why 30 minutes.
Okay, sir.
I'm saying that don't design something for 2 minutes endurance or 5 minutes endurance because it is too small a time. You will do some testing, you will do some balancing, you will do some initial checks that itself will consume 5 minutes. Then you will have limited time. You want to show it to somebody, you have spent half the time only in testing. And when you fly, you do 1 or 2 rounds and then the battery goes off. Then people get bored because now you have to change the battery. Instead, you give a decent endurance time. Okay, shall I go ahead? Okay,
yes,
the first thing that you need to understand is about aerostatics. That is the procedure and the mannerism by which you estimate the lift acting on the airship. So there are 2 kinds of lifts on the airship. There is a gross lift and the net lift. Let's first understand the difference between them. Gross lift basically is nothing but density of the ambient air into the envelope volume. This is the net upward buoyant force which is created. From there, you must subtract the weight of the lifting gas. Okay, so the net lift is going to be the lift which is available to you after you fill in the gas. So that is going to be the gross lift minus density of air. Density of gas. This is rho g, not rho a. Sorry, this is rho g into V E N B. So therefore, the net lift will be rho a minus rho g into V E N B. Let me just correct it right away. There is also something on the chat window. Okay. See, by the way, when I'm making a presentation, please remember I'm not able to see your chat windows. Okay. So if you want to tell me something, chat is meaningless because during chat, I'm just not able to see anything. So it is better that you do not send me messages on chat. It is better that you actually just... just speak out. Okay. Now, what are the factors that affect the net lift? Can you tell me, please, what do you think are the factors which affect net lift?
Sir, the atmospheric density.
Density of the ambient air, okay. Other than that? So, what factors affect the density?
Factors like altitude, temperature.
These are the four important. There are actually 9 parameters or 7 parameters. Out of that, some of them are not applicable for you. But, you know, these are the main parameters. So, internal pressure. If you put too much internal pressure, it's not a good thing from density point of view. Superheat. What is superheat? If you expose the airship to heat or ambient temperature for a very long time. Suppose you keep it in the sunny area, then also the lift will be affected. Okay. So what do you think will happen to the lift? Will it increase or decrease?
Sir, if the ambient density of the air decreases, the lift may be decreased.
No, I'm not talking about decreasing. I'm saying if you expose the airship to high temperature, what will happen?
The lift will slightly increase as the density of gas will reduce.
Why will density of the gas reduce because of high temperature?
As we provide the heat to the gas, it will expand, sir.
Yeah. So, what happens to rho A when you have temperature?
So rho A also decreases.
Yeah. So rho A will decrease. What about rho G? That is also decrease.
Yes, sir. If applied heat.
Then so both are decreasing.
I think it will balance out and cut off each other.
But then you mentioned that there will be envelope expansion.
Yes, sir.
Of the higher stress on the envelope because of heating. Okay. So you have to be careful. Humidity. In Mumbai, for example, we operate with very high humidity. And humidity basically means water in the air. And that actually is not desirable. So humidity also reduces the lift. And also gas purity. You will never get 100% pure gas. It will always be 95%, 98%, 99%. Even 99.99%. So purity of the gas also is going to affect the lift available. So all these factors have to be considered when you do the accurate calculation. Now, I don't have the time to go through all those things right now, but I'll tell you that I conduct a course on NPTEL called as Lighter Than Air Systems. How many of you know about that course? How many of you know about the course on LTS systems available online?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How many of you have done that course?
Yes, sir.
Half the way.
Half the way. Yeah. So you must have seen that there is a special chapter on static lift estimation. Okay. Then there is something called as center of buoyancy and center of gravity. So center of buoyancy is at the geometric center of the envelope volume, and center of gravity is where the net mass is acting. So these two are different. Generally, the center of buoyancy is below center of gravity is below center of buoyancy, because center of gravity is due to the items in the gondola, it will go down. And that is going to give you a moment. You have to be very careful about that. And then there is a concept of static heaviness. Can somebody explain to me what is meant by static heaviness? Those of you who have done the course, you should know this. Even if you have taken only the initial portion, I'm sure you should know about static heaviness. Can somebody explain to me? Sorry, I can't hear.
Sir, static heaviness is like the mass which is suspended to the LTA system.
No, that is not true. Anybody else? Define static heaviness.
Sir, it is basically controlling the vehicle's buoyancy to heavier than air ground operations.
No, but what is meant by static heaviness? Can you define it first? What you say is right, but what exactly is static heaviness? How do you measure it? So static heaviness is the difference between net lift and self-weight. Let's say if the net lift is 500 grams and the system weight is 600 grams, then the system is statically heavy by 100 grams. And this is what is used, as somebody mentioned, to make the airship heavier than air, so that if you lose control, it doesn't rise, it just slowly comes down because of heaviness. So although we call it as an LTA system, normally when we fly it heavier than air from safety and recoverability point of view. If the total lift is 500 grams and total weight of the system is only 400 grams, then it is statically light by 100 grams. Okay, now let us look at the design methodology. One by one, we will look at all components and see how they are designed. So, envelope sizing is the first and the most important thing. And it starts with the shape of the envelope. From the shape, you can get the dimensions of the envelope. From the dimensions, you can then decide the material that is to be used, not from the dimensions, but generally based on the applicability of the airship. And when you choose the material, then you will be able to calculate how much payload you can carry. So this is an exercise. So tomorrow we are going to do a tutorial in which we are going to calculate the numbers for a particular airship. But today I'm going to just show you the procedure. Ease of fabrication also is a very important consideration when you are going to design the envelope. Okay. So let us see this one by one. So here is the complete design methodology for a small indoor non-rigid electrical remotely controlled airship. So let me start. So what you do is, first you assume some length. Just assume some length. This is the starting number. All you require is it should be a positive number because this is the iterative loop. So first we assume the length. And based on the length and the envelope shape that you have selected, you can calculate the envelope volume. I call it as the initial envelope volume because the length has been chosen arbitrarily. Then you, there is again a mistake here. It is actually not initial estimate envelope volume, but initial estimate envelope length. So then you choose the envelope shape. Now, we will discuss in the next few slides about how envelope shape is chosen for an airship. But assume that there is some activity because of which you can decide which envelope shape to make. After you choose the envelope shape, because you know the length, you do the geometry sizing. That means you arrive at the dimensions of the envelope of a particular shape. Then you estimate the surface area of the envelope. Once you have surface area of the envelope, and because you have already chosen the envelope material, then you choose the envelope material, and with that you can estimate the weight of the envelope. So this is one important step. estimating the weight of the envelope. After that, once you have the envelope size, you can do tail sizing. Now, for tail sizing, there are many methods available. There is a rigorous method available, as well as there is a simple method available. We will discuss the simple method today, and then later on, you can go for a rigorous method also. So once you know the tail size, you can do the tail weight estimation. By tail, I mean the fins here. Okay? I mean the fins here. After that, since you know the geometry, since you know the tail size, you can create a CAD model. You can create a CAD model. Now, this particular step is optional. You may do it or you may not do it. I recommend that you do it, because if you make a CAD model, then you can actually use it to estimate drag using any of the standard CFD tools, if you know about them. Even otherwise, also, it's a good idea to make a CAD model, because you can then verify your geometry, surface area and volume calculations by using the CAD tools. Okay. So, which is the recommended CAD model for airship work? Which CAD tool should you use to make an airship? What would you use?
Sir, we generally use CATIA.
CATIA workbench.
Yeah, you use CATIA workbench, but don't use CATIA for this. Remember, CATIA is a tool which has been developed basically for detailed design. And it is more for mechanical design. What you are doing is called as aircraft conceptual design. So there is a better tool available for aircraft conceptual CAD creation. What is that tool?
Sir, the second application we use is ANSYS.
Again, ANSYS is not meant for initial CAD work. The amount of work that you need to do in ANSYS is quite a lot. See, these are all meant for analysis. CATIA is useful mostly for component assembly analysis. And ANSYS is also mostly used for analysis. I don't think ANSYS is a good CAD tool for initial quick design work. There is a tool called as OpenVSP. Have you heard about OpenVSP?
Yes, sir.
So OpenVSP I recommend as a tool, because it will quickly give you the volume, the area, and even drag if you use it properly. So that is enough for your purposes. Okay. Then after you do the CAD model, you can then do the drag and power computation, in which first you estimate the drag by estimating the CD. I calculate the drag acting. With the drag, you know what is the thrust required to be produced. With the thrust and the velocity, you can know what is the power required. With the power and the duration, you can come to know how much is the battery power needed. So you can do the electrical motor selection. Once you do electrical motor selection, you have to select the battery, the motor, the propeller, and there is something called as an ESC, electronic speed controller. All that together will give you the weight of the electrical motor. Okay. And then you do the selection of avionics. Now, the avionics on the airship will consist of various small items. For example, if you are using a remote control, you need to have a receiver on board. Okay. Then you also need to have some other things which are required to operate. So all these are done. All these are called clubbed together as avionics. So you need to take care of receiver, okay, batteries, motors, wires, etc. So you get the weight of avionic systems after that. Now you have all the weights available and you can calculate the lift from the envelope volume and the buoyancy of the gas depending on the weather conditions. So you can get lift minus weight, and that lift minus weight is actually going to be the payload. So if the requirement is met, which is very unlikely in the first iteration because you are choosing the length arbitrarily, then you have to change the envelope length and change the volume and then repeat the whole procedure iteratively. After you do it many times, you will come to a situation when you will be able to meet the payload requirement by increasing the volume or decreasing the volume. And then if you are ready, then you can say, okay, we can stop. Okay. So this is the methodology used for carrying out the sizing of the envelope. And now we are going to look at each step one by one. So before we go ahead, I'd like to know, do you have any questions about anything here?
Sir, don't we consider the weight of the gas while estimating the weight of the airship?
No. I already mentioned to you that when you do the net lift calculation, you already do rho A minus rho G into V. So automatically you have taken care of the weight of the lifting gas.
Okay, sir.
So the net static lift is basically available to overcome the weight of the system minus the lifting gas, because the net static lift, you have already taken care of the lifting gas. Or you can do gross lift minus everything, and also weight of the lifting gas. Any other question or any other point before we go ahead? See, you need to understand this completely, otherwise you will not be able to appreciate each box that we will now elaborate.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, do we consider static heaviness as a fixed parameter? I mean, we take it a fixed quantity and then we do the design?
Generally, we do that. Generally, what we do is, generally, we assume that the airship will be statically heavy by at least 10% of its net lift. So, that much additional lift you must have. Now, I have not shown it here. Actually, I'll talk to you about something called ballasting. So that is what is done to take care of static heaviness control. So yes, the lift capacity should be more than the payload by the amount of static heaviness that you want to provide.
Okay, sir.
Any other question or clarification before we go ahead? Okay, so if there are no questions, then I'll just go ahead and I'll start with the first one, which is the envelope sizing and fabrication. Now, this is a very important decision. How do you choose the shape of the envelope? Okay, so first you have to look at the geometrical considerations. Because you are working on an indoor airship, you have to be sure that you are able to accommodate that airship with sufficient margin for flying in the limited space that is available to you. So, the best shape for an airship from the geometrical considerations alone is a spherical shape. Why is that so?
Sir, it can accommodate the maximum volume in the least surface area.
Correct. A sphere is the shape which has the minimum surface area for a given amount of volume. Any other shape with the same volume will have higher surface area. And higher surface area means higher self weight, and also it will mean a little bit more drag. Plus the cost also, because you have to make it, right? But the problem with spherical shape is that spherical shape has got extremely high drag. It's a very draggy shape. So therefore, when you make a spherical shape, you are going to get more drag, and hence you will require a stronger and a more powerful motor, and hence it will become heavier. The other thing is that sphere is also a shape which is a very bluff body shape. And you know that behind every bluff body, when there is airflow, there is going to be some kind of a vortex shedding. Have you heard of something called as Karman vortex street? Do you know about Karman vortex street? Yes or no?
No, sir.
So Karman vortex street is it's an aerodynamic phenomena in which behind every bluff body, even if the flow is steady, you will get unsteady oscillatory flow behind. And there will be shedding of vortices in a systematic but alternating fashion, and that is leading to oscillation. So that is why, if you ever see any spherical balloon in the market, there are many companies which put up a spherical balloon to promote a product, some building society or some property. They put up these spherical balloons, and you will see that they keep oscillating a lot in the air. Okay? Whereas an aerostat does not oscillate in the air. That is because of the shape. So, spherical aerostats are easy to make, but they have very high drag and they are prone to a lot of oscillations. The next consideration will be the drag considerations. So, from the drag considerations, the best shape is the one that has got a higher length to diameter ratio. This is not lift to drag ratio. This is length to diameter ratio. High L by D. A longer shape, long length and small diameter, that shape has got a lesser drag. Of course, I cannot say this arbitrarily because beyond a particular value. So between L by D of around 3 to 5, drag is low. If you have L by D less than 3 or L by D more than 5, I cannot say that the drag is low. So the best L by D is between 3.2, 3.3 to around 4.5 or 5. 4.5, sorry, not even 5. So 3.3 to 4.5, you normally have a good, you have a very good drag characteristics for an envelope. But the problem is that if you use a shape with high L by D, then you are going to have more surface area per unit volume. So you will suffer with self-weight problem. And that means you will reduce the payload capacity. However, if you make a longer envelope, by longer I mean high L by D envelope, then you save on the weight of stabilizer because you get a larger moment arm. So on one hand, you have a spherical shape, which is the best surface area per unit volume, but high drag and more oscillations. On the other hand, you have a shape with high L by D, which will give you lesser area of stabilizer, but it will make your self weight large. So what do you do? Which shape do you choose? And how do you choose? This is a typical dilemma that is faced by an aerospace engineer when you go for shape optimization. So the solution to that is to have a compromise between the geometrical smallness and the aerodynamic drag considerations. So to do this, we have to look at the literature on what people have done. So, before that, based on the data of some existing airships which are commercially available, we have drawn this plot which shows you the general trend line between the general, we can show you the general trend line between the payload on the y-axis and the volume of the airship on the x-axis. So this is a data which has been fitted based on the literature survey of existing airships in the market. Okay, all the dots that you see are those for airships from a specific company. Okay, and the ones that you see in the green circle are the airships which have been constructed by us in the LTA Systems lab. So you will see that our airships are also broadly following the black line to give you the information that we are very much within the trends of the existing airships in the market. But this is only a first cut estimate, friends. You cannot use this as a law to calculate the payload for a given volume. Or if you want to calculate volume from payload, you cannot use this as a law. It is just a guideline to tell you that it increases in this fashion. Now, what choices do we have for envelope geometry? We can go for a shape which is called as the NPL shape. These are recommended shapes for airships, for good airships. NPL shape is given by a laboratory called as the National Physical Laboratory in UK. We have NPL in Ahmedabad also, but this is not that NPL. This NPL is the National Physical Laboratory in UK. So what they have done is, they say that one of the good shapes is a double ellipsoid shape in which from the maximum diameter portion, which is shown by the letter B, B is the maximum radius. So from the local, so there is one ellipse in the front, x square by a square plus y square by b square equal to 1. And on the back side, there is a bigger ellipse, which is x square by 2a square plus y by b square equal to 1. So we can realize that the semi-major axis of the rear envelope is root 2 times the semi-major axis of the front one. So this is a very, very well-established shape for airships. It gives you a long, slender airship with also good drag characteristics. So I will recommend that you use this shape. The other shape that is very popular is a shape given by a professor from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, called as Professor G.N.V. Rao. Unfortunately, he has passed away. He is no more. So in his respect, we call this shape as a GNVR shape. Lot of people have built airships and aerostats. Now, this shape is more suitable for aerostats rather than airships. But we have also built some airships using this particular shape. In fact, the first airship that we built, which I showed you, the micro airship, it was built using the GNVR envelope shape. Okay. And then we have another shape called as the Xeon shape. This shape has come from China. Okay, this is a Chinese airship, Xeon 1 actually. So there are some equations available for this profile. And we have also built one airship, this particular shape, because we found that the drag characteristics of this envelope were available and they were quite good. So there are many, many, many shapes in literature. I just showed you 3 of them. If you want to do a survey of literature, you can do and find out other shapes. Like there is a teardrop shape, which many people use. But again, teardrop shape is more useful for aerostats as compared to airships. Any questions anybody has on these 3 shapes for airships? No questions, no queries. What, are you getting tired towards lunchtime now? Lunchtime will be after 5 minutes.
No, sir. No, sir.
Yeah, only 5 minutes more I will take. I will stop at 1 o'clock sharp because I also want to take a short break and have lunch. So these are 3 shapes, but there can be more shapes. My recommendation to you will be to use NPL shape. Okay, that is my recommendation to you. Here is an example of the same double ellipsoid shape where, similar thing actually. And this is also just an information. It tells you that if you take a double ellipsoid shape, then the length of the front portion is 1.664 times diameter and the rear portion is about 2.336 times diameter. The length upon diameter ratio for this particular shape is 4. For example, if you add 1.664 and 2.336, you will get 4. Therefore, the L over D of this envelope will be 4, which is just at the border of the optimum L over D for low-speed airships. Beyond 4.5 L over D, again, airships start getting more drag. Okay, let us look at features of the envelope material. Selection of the envelope material is a very, very big decision making that you will do when you design airships. So we will spend some time discussing it. First important consideration is that the material that you take for airship should not be heavy. It should have a low self-weight. And self-weight of envelope materials is normally measured in a unit called as GSM, which is grams per square meter. GSM is a very common figure. For example, when you buy photocopying paper, you will see that the typical photocopying paper comes in around 70 to 80 GSM. That is the GSM of a photocopying paper. Okay. So common sense says that the GSM should be as low as possible so that the self-weight of the envelope and hence the airship is low. The next important consideration is that it should have low permeability to helium and hydrogen or any other lifting gas. Because if it is a lightweight material, but it is highly permeable, then the gas will not stay. And then the whole purpose of using it for LTA system is defeated. So maybe I should put permeability as the first requirement, and then I should put the GSM requirement. Another requirement is high tear strength. That means the load required to tear the envelope should be high. This allows you to handle the envelope easily and also avoids damage to the envelope because of loads. Another requirement is high flexibility, because you are going to pressurize the envelope and you are going to compress and decompress many times. It is important that the envelope should be flexible. It should not be that if you fold it twice or thrice, it starts getting creases, it starts getting cracks, and it starts misbehaving. So flexibility of the material, that means refoldability of the material, is very important. And of course, you are supposed to make the envelope. And to make the envelope, you have to seal it. You have to join it. So sealability, it should be easy to seal it. So these are some of the important considerations for the features of the envelope material. Selection of the envelope material is done based on these considerations. Any doubts or any questions about it? Because in the next slide, I'm going to show you some materials and then we are going to stop for lunch. Okay, so based on the requirements which I have shown you, low GSM, high tear strength, low permeability, high flexibility, and sealability, we have done a lot of research in this in the last so many years in LTA Systems Lab, and we have come up with some materials which are excellent candidates. The first of that is metallized polymer. Okay, metallized polymer. Okay, or you can call it aluminized polymer also. This comes in the market in two versions generally. That is what we have found, but you might find some other also. Either you get it as 65 grams per square meter, which is almost like a paper thin, or there is a thicker one which comes in 150 grams per square meter. Any one of you has tasted these ready-made food which is to be heated in the microwave or put it in a boiling water, you know, ready to eat upma?
Yes, sir.
You know, that comes in a silver foil. That silver foil is basically metallized polymer. So it is very easily available. And the one that you use for instant food is normally the 150 GSM. But for you know, making these food packets or for aluminum foils. Now, aluminum foil is not polymerized. It is just aluminum. So that may not be good. It will tear very easily. But metallized polymer has a very good tear. It's easily available, not at all expensive. The next material is PVC coated nylon. Nylon base, nylon 66 base with PVC coating, that becomes about 180 GSM, because the PVC coating cannot be made below about 120 GSM, unfortunately. And then you have pure PVC, just PVC itself. It could come in 210 GSM or 250 GSM. That is generally what is available. So for your indoor remotely controlled airship, you will probably have to go for any one of these three materials. Okay. So with that, we come to the end of the session before lunch. It's exactly 1 o'clock. I would like to stop the discussion and continue.